Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works, His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
Well, good morning. My name is Pastor Samuel Mead, and I have the privilege of opening up our new series, Sound Bites. So I'm glad you could all join us. It's a blessing to have you guys here Sunday and those watching online. I'm glad you're able to tune in. And the Sound Bites series, what we'll be looking at that is we'll be closely examining the last words of Jesus Christ as he was hung on the cross. We'll be looking at those words. And that's important because those last words were some of his greatest words of love and the greatest words of love ever spoken. So it's super important. That's why we're going to look at it. We're going to dig into it. But before we do that, I'd like to open with a story. Now, this story is very true. It's very real. It's nonfiction. The events really did happen. About 23 years ago, the East African country of Rwanda descended into a bloody genocide. In 1994, the country was shook and the world sat back and watched as almost 1 million Rwandans were killed. Former President Bill Clinton said that his failure to intervene in Rwanda was his biggest regret. It was a huge ordeal. And see, the genocide, to understand why it happened, we have to look a little bit back in history. Rwanda was colonized by some European countries, and when they colonized Rwanda, they brought with them their own socioeconomic kind of class system. And it divided the people of Rwanda up into different groupings based on, you know, their class, kind of what they did, their jobs. And the people of Rwanda over generations kind of adopted that, and that became who they were. They didn't know anything else. And this class divided them up into two primary groups, the Hutus and Tutsis. Now, there were some other groups, but those were the primary ones. The Hutus and Tutsis made up the majority of the population. Now, the Hutus and Tutsis looked exactly the same. They, more times than not, had the same religion. They had the same background, the same culture, the same heritage. They were the same. The only difference was this division in the hierarchical system that kind of had been injected into their country. That's the only reason they were different. Yet, because of this, they despised each other. They hated each other because of this division. Hutus hated Tutsis, and Tutsis hated Hutus. Now, there were some, you know, individuals who didn't, but the majority of the population, they hated each other. They despised each other. And the genocide was the climax of the schism. That's what happened when the president of Rwanda, he was a Hutu, and he was killed. We don't know by who. He was just killed. And that's what sparked the genocide. When he was killed, the country descended into chaos. Hutus just started, they went on a mass mission to exterminate the Tutsi race. They just started killing them everywhere. See, they had ID cards, and if the ID card, they asked them to see it, and if it was Tutsi, they would kill him right there. If they were Hutu and they didn't have their ID card, they would kill him right there. They used guns, explosives, knives, machetes, whatever they could get their hands on. They would brutally murder the Tutsis. Now, disclaimer, it's kind of graphic, but they would rape the women. They would take the children and throw them against the wall over and over again. They enjoyed it. It was pure evil, pure and raw evil. And in the middle of all of this was a young woman named Immaculée Ilibagiza. You can see her picture up there. She was my age when this happened. She's actually a year younger than me. She was 22. And after her home had been attacked, she fled to a local pastor, and the local pastor took her in and hid her in a bathroom, a 3-by-4-foot bathroom, with 7 other women. 8 women, not children, women, hid in this bathroom. They couldn't even all sit. They had to take turns standing and sitting. She was in that bathroom for 91 days. And on multiple occasions, she couldn't eat for days. The pastor could only sneak food to her ever so often. And then on top of that, she was still being hunted. The Hutus were on a mission to find all Tutsis. And the sad thing is they weren't like separate villages. They grew up together, so they all knew each other. So the Hutus were hunting the Tutsis. They knew Immaculée. So they would be right outside, a few feet from the secret door she was hidden. They'd be screaming, "Come out! Come out, Immaculée!" It's terrifying. The neighbors, she knew them. And they were hunting her. Miraculously, she survived. When she exited the bathroom, she came into the bathroom 115 pounds and left 65 pounds. And when she exited, the tide of the genocide had begun to turn. The Tutsi rebel fighters had started combating just the onslaught and the killing. And the French military forces had also kind of come in and started helping with that. And not just Immaculée, but eyewitness accounts report just miles and miles of bodies lining the side of the road. As far as I could see, the sound of the flies buzzing so loud you couldn't even hear cars. The stench was wherever you were. And Immaculée, in the aftermath, got the chance to meet. See, she had a family. And she got the chance to meet one of the men who had brutally murdered her mother and her brother. Immaculée survived, but her family did not. Sadly, her two parents and her three brothers were all brutally murdered in different ways. When one man in particular, a particular leader of the Hutu forces, had gruesomely killed her mother and her brother, and Immaculée was going to get the chance to meet him. She went to the prison where he was being held at, and she knew the prison warden. Once again, it was a small community, so they knew each other. And the prison warden was friends with her father, so he knew. And he knew all his prisoners. He knew what they had done and why they were in there. And so when Immaculée came, he knew exactly why she was there. He went and grabbed the man who had killed her mother and brother and brought him in. And he threw him on his knees right before. He made her get on his knees and look up at her. She was facing the man who had hunted her. And it dawned on her when she was looking at him that she knew that man. The man on his knees before, she knew him. She actually had grown up with him. He had been a friend of her father's. She had played with his children in school. And she also recognized that it was his voice that had been screaming her name when she was hiding in the bathroom in terrifying silence. And now she had the chance to administer her version of justice, her version of revenge, whatever she wanted. And the jailer wanted that. He had told her, "Do what you want, you know, I won't tell anybody." It was her chance to get even. So I ask you, what would you do if you're in Immaculée's shoes? What would you do if you were in her situation right now and you were looking at the man who brutally killed your mother and brother? Would you forgive him? Forgiveness is tough. It's hard. It's an awkward subject. And that's because we've been in both spots. We've been the person who was wounded, and we've been the person who was wounded. We've hurt others, and we've been hurt. We've been in both spots. That's why it's hard to talk about. That's why it's awkward. And I understand. I can't count the times I've hurt my wife, Olivia. I've done stupid things, and I've hurt her, and I know I'm wrong, and I still have a hard time uttering the words, "Will you forgive me?" It's hard. Maybe when she admits what she did wrong, how she rolled her eyes, checked her attitude, then we can talk. Then I'll lay out my mistakes too. See, even when I know I'm 100% wrong, it's still hard. Because I have to swallow a pill of pride. It's not easy. It's not human nature to forgive. It doesn't come easy at all. And that's kind of where the heart of this message is. Forgiveness. See, what we do is we take forgiveness and we put it behind us. And we just keep on moving. We don't even worry about it. What's a situation I'm not going to deal with? You know, I don't get forgiven, so I'm not going to forgive. Something I can do without. But what happens is when you throw that forgiveness behind you, it starts to pick up other things. It starts to pick up anger, resentment, depression, guilt. And so people say, I don't deal with unforgiveness. But those are the symptoms of unforgiveness. So when we're shoving it under a rock and we actually look under the rock and we get down to what the real problem is, it's unforgiveness. See, Rick Warren, a pastor of a megachurch, once said that the root of all problems is relational. See, at the key of it, at the heart of all the issues, it's most likely unforgiveness. It's a situation that was not dealt with. Or how you hurt somebody and you've never been to rectify the guilt. You were never forgiven. Here's the heart of the message. And if you walk away with anything today, walk away with this. Jesus Christ came and died on the cross to forgive you. See, but you've probably heard that before. Most people have. Most people don't even come to church have heard that. Yeah, I've heard that. Here's the other half. This is the part that's so important that people forget. Jesus Christ came to earth to forgive you. But he also came to empower you to forgive others. It was a dual purpose. He died on the cross for that reason. On the cross, Jesus was all alone. His best friends betrayed him and denied him. His family, they couldn't do anything. The crowds that had been following him and admiring his teachings were now laughing at him, jeering, mocking, ripping his beard out. And the raw brutality of the beatings that happened, whipping him and ripped the flesh from his back. And the nails that pierced his wrists and his feet. Being crucified back then was the most painful and the most humiliating way to die. And how did Jesus respond? When we look in our Bibles, if you want to open up your Bibles or follow in the outline, we go to Luke. And we see in Luke chapter 23, verses 33 and 34, when they came to a place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." They don't know what they are doing. They don't know that they're killing an innocent man. They don't know that they're crucifying the Son of God. They don't know. And he wasn't just talking about an angry mob 2,000 years ago. When he said they don't know, he's talking about the human race. He's talking about you and me. See, the human race has a human condition. And that condition is one of stain. The stain of sin. I lie, I cheat, I take, I deceive. I want to do what's right, but I'm willing to do what's wrong if it gets what I want. The human condition is one of stain. We're stained. And the writers of Scripture portray it as the human condition is stained. The human character is stained. The world that God created and that he loves is stained because of us. So what would it be like to meet a God who is not stained, who is unstained, a perfect and holy God? Well, the prophet Isaiah paints this picture. "Woe is me, I'm ruined. I am a man of unclean lips. I live in the midst of a people of unclean lips, and I've seen a holy God." See, he recognizes that he's stained and all those around him are stained, and that God isn't. Peter, the disciple Peter, when he recognized Jesus for the first time for who he really was, he was the Son of God. He recognized that. He says, "Get away from me, Lord. I'm a sinful man. I'm stained." He saw that there was a separation. There was a gap. He had been stained. And how does Jesus respond? Well, Jesus says, "I take all of that on me. I take your anger, your depression, the guilt you deal with, I take it on me on the cross. I take your stain of sin on me on the cross. See, Jesus paid our debt when he did that. He paid a moral debt that we could and would never pay. That's what Jesus did when he took it. Once again, Isaiah shows us, he describes the experience like this. He was pierced for our sins. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. By his wounds, we are healed. See, Jesus did that because he loved us. It wasn't a mistake. It wasn't an accident. He didn't come to earth and say, well, I guess I'll get them too. No, he came with a plan and a purpose. And that was to forgive you and to empower you to forgive others. That was his purpose when he came. See, it's so key. The reason we're looking at these last words is because nowhere in the Bible do you see an example greater of love and forgiveness than when Jesus is hanging on the cross, gasping for air. And he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. There's no example greater than that. So what does it look like? What does it look like when we admit our sins and we accept God's forgiveness? Well, Scripture tells us that four things happen. The first one is that God forgives instantly. It's instant. Isaiah 55:7. God is merciful and quick to forgive. It happens immediately. It's not, he doesn't say, let me let you think about that. Let me let you deal with the guilt for a little bit. When we pray, please forgive me, it happens immediately, right there and then. It's quick. The second one is that God forgives me completely. Colossians 2:13-14. He has forgiven all your sins. Why don't you go ahead and underline that? He has forgiven all your sins. He has utterly wiped out the evidence of broken commandments, which always hung over our heads, and has completely annulled it by nailing it to the cross. So which sins did he forgive? All of them. All your sins. Not just the ones of yesterday or that you did last week. Not just the ones of even today that you're going to do later. He did the ones for tomorrow and the next day. He did all of them. All of them have been forgiven. You were completely forgiven. Why don't you go ahead and circle wiped out also? Because God's forgiveness is a super stain remover. It completely wipes it out. Strongest detergent you'll ever see. It completely wipes out the stain of sin. It's powerful. And we think, oh, well, he probably hasn't, even though he has forgiven us completely, we think, maybe he hasn't. So we think, if you get to heaven and you're going to go up to God and say, about that one sin we talked about, he's going to look at you and he's going to say, what sin? When he has forgiven you, it's instant and it's complete. Psalm 103:12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. That's pretty far. It's gone. It's complete. The third one is God forgives me repeatedly. Have any of you ever sinned and then prayed for forgiveness and then sinned that same sin again and prayed for forgiveness again? I know I have. It's embarrassing. But it happens over and over again. Here's the truth. God doesn't get tired of forgiving you. It's in his nature. He's loving and merciful. God loves to forgive you. He never gets tired of it. He never gets bored of it. Lamentations 3:22-23. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And the last one, and this one is probably the most important one, is that he forgives me freely. It's free. His gift of love and forgiveness. It's a free gift. We didn't earn it, and we don't deserve it. There's nothing we can do to ever deserve it. Nonetheless, he still gave it free. See, because you're a human being, your single greatest need is forgiveness. It's your single greatest need. And God's greatest gift of forgiveness was his son. See, that's why Jesus says, I have forgiven you more than you will ever know. So now you forgive others more than they will ever know. So how do we do that? I understand how God forgives me. How do I start forgiving people? Because it's hard. And God more than anybody gets that. It's not easy. Well, I've laid out three practical steps that will help you get started on that process. That will help walk you through that process, because it is a process. The first one is identify the people who have hurt you. Identify the people who have hurt you. You have to take an evaluation of your life. Has anybody hurt me? No, I don't deal with issues of unforgiveness. Remember we talked about earlier, there's symptoms. Check the symptoms. Are you angry? Are you ever sad? Do you ever have physical pain? A lot of times physical pain is tied to unforgiveness too. Oh, my back is hurting all the time. Well, you're probably holding something inside that you haven't let go of. See, we have to figure out, and I'm a practical guy, so I like to write it down. I think writing it down is powerful. It makes it real. It puts it in front of you. It takes the thing you've put behind you and puts it in front of you. Identify the name. Whether it doesn't matter if it's a family member, a friend, the clown at Walmart. If somebody hurts you, you got to write it down. A teacher who embarrassed you, somebody who abused you. Write the name down. Make it real. Writing it down is important because it sheds light on the denial most of us live in. We like to deny that we don't have issues of unforgiveness. But when we write it down, we're making it real. We're putting light on it. The second step is a little bit harder. You determine what they owe you. Determine what they owe you. If you and I were to sit down in a meeting and we had the person whose name you wrote down come and join us, what would they need to give you to make it right? What do they owe you? What will it take to make it even? Because it's something. Write it next to their name. What does that person owe you? Does he owe you an apology? Does she owe you an explanation? Does that person owe you a marriage that they took away from you? Does he owe you time because he works too much? Does your father owe you a childhood? Does a drunk driver owe you a life? They owe you something. You need to write it down. That's only 2/3 of the way there. And this last step, it's the hardest, but it's the most important. Cancel their debt. But why? Why in the world would I ever cancel their debt? They don't deserve that. I'm letting them off the hook. Why would I ever do that? Well, here's the truth. When it comes to authentic Christ-like forgiveness, it doesn't settle the issue of blame. It doesn't settle the issue of getting even or who's right. That's because Christ-like blame, Christ-like forgiveness settles the issue of legitimate debt. It cancels out a legitimate debt. When Christ came and died, he canceled a legitimate moral debt that you and I owed. So what do we have to do? We have to cancel the debt of others. On that piece of paper, if you wrote it on your Connect card, you take it one step further, cross their name out. Write paid in full. Then you can throw in the offering back at the end of service. You're letting them go. You're letting them go. And it's hard. Because when you let them go, you're letting go of your right to get even. You're letting go of your right to be right. You're letting go of your right to win. You're letting go of your right to see justice, to get revenge. But I'm telling you, when you let them go, something powerful happens. When you let them go, you let yourself go. See, when you let them go, you're releasing a prisoner. The prisoner is not them. It's you. You're the prisoner. And when you're released, That allows God to come in and radically change your life. See, when you let people go, you let yourself go. When you let yourself go, you let God in. And when you let God in, there's nothing like it. It's a radical change. Powerful. But I'm not saying it's simple. It's a process. So we had a young woman in our church who actually walked through this process of letting go and asked her to share her story with you. So would you please watch?
My name is Emily Hoapili, and I've been coming to Vineyard for about a month now. I was looking for a new church and found this one online. I can say confidently that 2016 was one of the worst years of my life. It started out with several of my very close family members dealing with really serious life-threatening illnesses. And then halfway through the year, I lost my job and I had to move back to Virginia. I'd been living in South Carolina. And then towards the end of the year, I felt like I was under attack. I was hurt by several people that I had trusted, and I felt my anger starting to seep in. Physically, I was exhausted, but spiritually, I was struggling very much. It became easier for me to just be angry instead of working to forgive. And I look back on that time almost as if I was seeing God through a dirty window. I could see him if I concentrated, but it was much harder to see his light and feel his warmth shine through. I came to Vineyard at the end of January, and at the time I wasn't sure what was prompting me to do so, but looking back, I now know it was the Holy Spirit. Within a few days, I could hear God speaking to me again, and I got plugged into a Connect group, which was incredible, and finding a community that was able to hold me up and pray with me and allowed me to hear God's voice again. Within a week, I was baptized. I was one of the many that weekend that hadn't planned on doing so, but felt the Holy Spirit guide me to do so. And it was something that I had never done as an adult. I was baptized as an infant, and following that, it just felt like this huge weight had been lifted and that I was able to move forward and let go of all the pain from last year and just concentrate on my new walk with Christ. There wasn't a magic formula for me to follow. I realized that when I had allowed anger and pain to dominate my thoughts, that's when I stopped hearing God. And really, I just had to let it go. I had to pray on it and just move forward. And I learned that there's times where we have to forgive and keep working on relationships, and that there's times where we have to forgive and let go and let God. That's all I can do, and I just work to hear his voice. His voice to me is one of love and forgiveness, and now as I move forward in my faith, I need to work and learn to shine that light towards others and be an example of forgiveness, especially when I still know so many people who are hurt and feeling pain, that I can be an example to them.
What a great story. It's not simple. It's not a simple process, but it's a necessary process. So, so necessary. And trust me, I really do get it. I promise you I get it. I can't count the times in my life that I've been hurt. Hurt by people really close to me. It's painful. It's hard to let go. The last thing I want to do is forgive them. And I'm embarrassed to say it, but it's so true. It's not in my DNA. And that might be because I'm the oldest child of three boys, and I grew up always wanting things fair, but I am not about it. I wanted things to always be fair. It's not my natural instinct to forgive. Only when I slow down and think that forgiveness came at a cost. It came at a cost to God. He sent his only son. It came at a cost to Jesus dying on that cross. It's going to cost me. It's going to cost me my will, my pride. It's going to cost me to live an upside down life. Because Christians are always called to live upside down. It's not the norm. See, we are asked to forgive not because they deserve it. We're asked to forgive because we have been forgiven. Colossians 3:13. You must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. What do we remember? We remember that God forgave us. We remember the cross. We remember what Jesus did. See, when we do that, when we remember, forgiveness actually becomes a little bit easier. When you remember that Jesus forgave Samuel, it's easier for Samuel to forgive others. See, society says forgive and forget. But the Apostle Paul is saying in Colossians, forgive and don't forget. You don't forget the cross. You remember the cross. If the cross is your backdrop, then forgiveness becomes easier. It's only when we recognize that that we're able to take the first step in forgiving people. It's hard, though. Here's a little trick I've learned when it comes to forgiving. You have to adjust your focus. See, when you focus on the person who wounded you, who hurt you, all you see is, I'm letting them go. They're not getting what they deserve. I'm letting them off the hook. They do not deserve this. You have to adjust your focus. Don't focus on him. Focus on him. That makes sense? Don't focus on him. You focus not on the one who hurt you, but on the one who paid such a high price for your forgiveness. You adjust your focus. Now, one of the things I like to do that helps me adjust my focus and reminds me is to take communion. So Daniel mentioned we're going to do that together today. So the ushers are going to come forward now and start passing out communion and elements. And I ask you to hold on to them because we're going to take them together. And don't worry, I'll wait until everybody has the elements. Communion, it's a symbol and a reminder. The symbol and a reminder. The Apostle Paul says, remember. Communion does that. It's a reminder. It's a reminder of what Jesus did. It's a reminder that Jesus paid it all on the cross. It's a reminder that Jesus forgave you. Jesus forgave you. That's what it's reminding us of. Sometimes it really is easy to forget that. As we're going through the day-to-day motions of life, it's easy to forget. Yeah, Jesus did that thing that one time. Jesus paid it all. It cost him everything. And it's a free gift to you. So when we take communion, it's a reminder of that. But communion is also a symbol. See, we do communion here every weekend on Saturdays at the Saturday service, and then we do it once a month on the weekend service. And whenever I speak on Saturdays for the communion, I love to remind people that communion doesn't just remind us of something that happened so long ago. It's a symbol of what we get to do today because of what happened so long ago. It's a symbol of how you are able to forgive others because you have been forgiven. And that's the heart of it all. So Immaculate, looking at the man, kneeling before her, she began to cry. She remembered the time she spent in the bathroom. But see, that's important. That's important because there's another part to the story. See, when she was in that bathroom for 91 days, she forged a profound and lasting relationship with Jesus Christ. The pastor had given her a Bible when she was in that room. She read it and prayed every single day. was in that bathroom that she accepted the forgiveness of Christ. So when she was looking at the man who was kneeling before her, she began to cry. Didn't know what to say. And the jailer grabbed the man, yanked him up by the scruff of his neck. He knew something needed to happen. What do you have to say to her? What do you have to say to Immaculate? The man just began to sob. He was overcome by guilt and pain. He looked at Immaculate just for a second, but they locked eyes in that moment. She reached out her hand and gently touched his. He saw the pain. He said, "I forgive you." How in the world did she do that? That man murdered her mother and her brother, hunted her, wanted to kill her. And yet, she forgave him. See, forgiveness doesn't make sense unless you've been forgiven. It's only when we remember the cross do we understand forgiveness. So before we take communion, I just want to pray a prayer. I want to pray a prayer where we accept Christ's forgiveness. We're not called to live this life in the bondage of anger and sadness and pain and all those things that come with unforgiveness. If you're living with that, you're not living your life to the fullest. I want to pray a prayer of release. If you would bow your heads with me. Father, I know without a doubt that there are people here and people watching online that are struggling with the pain of living with guilt, knowing they've hurt others, and the pain that others have caused them. Yeah. Deep-rooted pain. Pain that's been there for years. Longer than we can remember. Well, I pray in the name of Jesus that this is the day of their release. That this is the day of their relief. Let this be the day of their freedom that comes with your forgiveness. Take off the chains of unforgiveness. Now I want to invite you to pray with me and accept the free gift of forgiveness and love that Jesus offers. If you've never accepted Christ, then this is an acceptance of his gift of salvation. And it's powerful. Now I want you to say something like this in your mind. Remember, you're just talking to God, you and God. He knows your forgiveness pain. He knows what's there. Say with me, "Dear God, you know everything about me. You know everything that I'm ashamed of. You know my regrets, my sins. You know my mistakes. You know my habits. You know my actions and attitudes that are the roots of unforgiveness. I agree with you that I have done wrong, that I have sinned. And many times I have done what I wanted to do rather than the right thing. But I not only admit this, I accept responsibility for it. And I'm not going to blame anybody else in my life. I'm not going to make any excuses. I'm going to own up to what's wrong with me in my life. I want to change. I want to go your way. I repent. I want to follow you, and I want to trust you completely. Jesus Christ, thank you. Thank you for what you did and what you said on the cross. Thank you for saying, Father, forgive them, because I believe that. I ask you to forgive me for even the things I do not know about. Take away all my unforgiveness. I thank you for paying out my sins, for canceling my debt, so I could be forgiven. And now in faith, I do accept your gift of forgiveness and salvation. Thank you for forgiving me instantly and completely. Thank you for forgiving me repeatedly. And most of all, thank you for forgiving me freely. Please help me to feel forgiven and to forgive myself and to forgive everybody else around me. And with your head still bowed, if you sincerely prayed that prayer, then I want to say to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.